Hi. My name is Matt. Some of you probably knew me better as Duke. And I'd like to introduce you to my co-host for today's episode, or tonight's episode, or this morning's episode. This is my good friend Computer. Say hi, Computer. Well, it's good to see you too. Now, I thought I would do an Apple II stream because computers have been in the news a lot recently with the Meltdown and the Spectre and the processors and the Intel. What do all these buzzwords mean? I sure don't know. So I thought I would invite Computer on to try to shed a little bit of light on things. What the heck has been going on? Where did your mouth go, computer? Oh, okay. Well, that makes sense. So, could you give us some clue as to what's been going on? Why is this 20-year-old computer bug suddenly making everyone panic, Could you just give us the breakdown? Well, I gotta be honest, that all just went way over my head. I know you tried your best, computer, and I appreciate it. Well, you did your best, don't worry about it. But I have a program here that might give us a little bit more insight about what's going on inside of the computers. No, not inside of you. Computer. I'm talking about the physical computer sitting on our desks right now, or the computer in our pockets, since a lot of people don't have the kind of computers that sit on desks, but I do. What? Oh, well, to be honest, computer, I liked your last face a little bit better. This one seems a little bit squashed, but that's okay. Oh, nope. Nope, wrong direction, computer. It's okay. We'll come back and talk to computer some more later. For now, I'm going to jump into a little program called. Just a moment, please. The Inside Story. Welcome to The Inside Story, copyright 1984. Apple Computer Incorporated. In the last Apple II stream, I started with an introduction to the Apple IIc, which is one of the discs that came with the Apple IIc computer. And this is another one. This is it's just a little look into the innards, the inner workings of the mysterious computer. And with all the Meltdown, Spectre, hullabaloo, I thought it might be a good idea to get a little refresher about all that, because I don't know what's going on. Oh, look at that. It printed the text first, and then it somehow converted it all to high resolution graphics text. That's really interesting. Okay, so this looks like what we want. We want to know what the problem is. We want to know what all the drama around all of these computer bugs is, and we get to play a fun game at the end. So, yeah, this is exactly what I was looking for. Welcome to The Inside Story, a special part of the interactive guide to the Apple IIc. I don't know if it's waiting for input. I suppose it is. Okay, you really should have said that to begin with. To show you just how the Apple does its job, we've prepared a little detective story for your enjoyment. Ooh. Our gripping saga outlines the basic steps of computer operation and explain some computer buzzwords along the way. Thank God, you know, all of these buzzwords, they just have my head spinning. So I'm really, really glad to hear that. There are three parts, and we recommend you go through all of them in order. Well, of course, I mean, we don't want to jump ahead. At the end, you can play the inside story game. It will help you remember the concepts presented in the story. Okay, good. Anytime you want to go back to the menu, just press the escape key. You don't need to try it now. Oh, oops. Well, I guess I should have read a little bit more carefully. It's okay. To start the action, just press return or press escape to go back to the menu. It was hot in Silicon Valley that day, but business was ice cold. I had been sitting in my office all afternoon, killing time and alien invaders on my Apple IIc. I'm Sherlock Capslock, one of the best private eyes in the valley. Suddenly, there was a woman's knock at the door. I got my 10 toes off the desk and said, "Come in." Whoa. Graphics. And look at that font, that's awesome. "Excuse me, are you Mr. Capslock?" "Yeah, that's me. What can I do for you?" "Oh, it has different fonts for the different characters. That's nice." "Well, I'm glad I found you. I'm Nancy Novice, and I've just had a little accident with my Apple IIc." "What happened? Lose some important data or something?" Actually, you probably would have pronounced it data, but that's a controversial subject we'll get into later. "That's right, I was typing something this morning, and suddenly the power went off before I could print anything. And then I heard the strange laughter, like somebody had done it intentionally. What's going on?" "Well, it looked like Miss Novice had a run-in with that creep Blackie Power Out, but I didn't want to alarm her, so I just said, 'Listen, Miss Novice, there's a lot going on, but I'll get you set up so you won't have to sit through a rerun of this morning.'" "Really? What are you going to do?" "Just step over here to my desk. I'm going to give you the inside story on the Apple IIc." Well, I think I will press return for Sherlock's inside tour. I'm captivated. We walked over to my Apple IIc. It really looked good sitting there. I turned it around and said, "Now, Miss Novice, you've got a bird's eye view with the keyboard on the left, and since this is a special 2C with a transparent top, ooh, you can actually see the logic board inside." "Oh, logic board. That's really impressive, Mr. Capslock. It looks pretty complicated." "Well, it is, but we'll take it step by step and you'll catch on in no time." "That's fine, go ahead." First, notice the disk drive. It takes information off a floppy disk or puts information on it. But the real action goes on here with all the integrated circuits, called chips. They're silicon wafers with electronic circuits etched inside. And this is the big guy, the boss, the microprocessor, the brain of the whole system. This bunch of chips over here is the read-only memory, or ROM for short. The guys at Apple put information in ROM that stays there all the time, whether the power is on or off. What kind of information? Oh, things like the AppleSoft basic programming language, but don't worry, you don't really need to know much about ROM. Last but not least are the chips that make up random access memory, or RAM. Now, RAM is nothing to sneeze at. Why? What's so great about RAM? Good question, something I ask all the time. That's where your information was when you had trouble this morning. Let me show you what happened. When the power is on, your information is in RAM. That's some good info. But if the power goes off, all the info goes away. Oh, so I've got to make a permanent copy of my work on a disk. Right, you're catching on. Yes, I think so, but I still don't see what all this has to do with the Apple IIc and me. Miss Novice was with me all the way so far, but now I had to take her a little deeper. I'm glad it gives you a chance to take a breather between these chapters. But, you know, I'm so into the story. I've got to press on. I've got to level with you, Miss Novice. We're up against Blackie Powerout, a master criminal who preys on computer novices. Really? What does this Blackie do? He shows up unexpectedly and pulls the power plug. Unless you're on your toes with your 2C, you'll be kissing some important info goodbye and saying hello to a lot of extra work. That's right, I had to retype everything I lost this morning. Hope it isn't too much. Now, let's retrace this morning's events. Sure. First, I put a startup disk in the disk drive and turn on the computer. When you do that, the microprocessor takes some instructions from ROM and then checks the disk drive for a disk. Watch. It's amazing. You can watch the magic happening right before your eyes. If there's a disk, the microprocessor looks for an operating system on it. The microprocessor needs the operating system to handle the flow of information between the disk and RAM, the temporary storage area. So a copy of this operating system is put in a RAM like this. Dang. That's a lot of RAM taken up just by the OS. Sometimes your disk also has a program on it. I mean, I would hope so. And that gets put into RAM next. A little bit at a time. You mean the program is on the disk and that's why the 2C can be a game machine 1 minute and a word processor or whatever the next? You got it. It's a program that creates a personality of the computer. You were using a word processor this morning, weren't you? Yes, I was. Okay, so you had started up, or booted, the 2C. And you had RAM with the operating system and the word processing program loaded in. What did you do next? I started typing, and I kept it up for almost half an hour. Then the accident happened, or should I say, the crime. Let me show you what was going on when you were typing. Type your first name now and then press return. Oh, is it actually asking me or? Okay. Should I type my first name or should I type hers? Oh boy. Delete? Yeah, there we go. Oh, it's not going to let me do lowercase? Oh, fair. Oh, there it goes. The way the emulator interacts with the caps lock key can be a little funky sometimes. Okay. Nancy. You know, I want to play the role here. See, whatever you type appears on your screen and gets put into RAM. I get it. Nothing I've typed is permanent yet because it's just in RAM and not on the disk. Absolutely. Hey, you're good at this stuff. If you want to keep your info, you've got to send it from RAM to the disk. Each program will differ in the exact way you do this, but the principle is always the same. Let's see, how do I know where to put it on the disk? Good question. In fact, you don't have to worry about where. That's one of the jobs of the operating system. Oh man, imagine if you had to figure out on your own which sectors you wanted to write every bit of information to. It's like this. All the stuff on the disk is kept in various files. A file can contain anything. An operating system, a program, a letter to anti-shift, whatever. But each file on a disk has to have its own unique file name. And when you save your info, you pick that file name. Say you choose the file name my.name. Here's what happens when you save. I see. I can make the file name anything I want. Within certain limits, yes, but it's a good idea to pick a name that describes the contents of the file. But the really important point is to save frequently, every 10 minutes or so. And that's what you didn't do this morning, and Blackie caught you. The power went off and all your work disappeared from RAM. What happened? Is he here again? Nah, that was me. I just switched off the 2C myself. Watch what happens when I switch it back on. As I said, this is called starting up or booting the Apple IIc. And now I can get back the work I stored on the disk, can't I? You got it. You can load a copy of my.name back into RAM. Again, the exact way you do this will be a little different with each program. But the idea is the same. Put a copy of the info you want to work on into the computer, like this. I remember my name. And there are the contents of my.name and RAM. Now go ahead and change the name. Press return when you're finished. Oh. Well, I don't want to potentially change it to something she's not happy with. I'll just change it to her full name instead. No, not Novi. No, not... Ugh. The way the delete / arrow keys work is just completely unintuitive. Also, you have to type slowly when it's in this graphical input mode, because there's a little bit of lag between pressing a key and it processing it into graphics. I get it. I changed the info in RAM, but the file on the disk is exactly as it was. Right. Now you can save again, and you've got a couple of possibilities. I can save the information as my.name again. That's fine. If you do that, though, you'll write over the old file. You could also pick a new file name and keep the old version around. Ooh, version control. It's up to you. Just remember, saving things with the same file name will erase the old file. Well, Ms. Novice, I hope this little tour of the Apple IIc was helpful. Yes, Mr. Caps Lock, it's been a great help. And now I've got a little surprise for you. I couldn't believe my peepers. This novice woman reaches up and takes off her false nose and then her wig. It was Rita Return underneath. Rita Return? What's happening? What are you doing here? Hi, Sherlock. Just checking you out. I can't believe it. What's all this about Nancy Novice? You're one of the engineers at Apple who designed the 2C. That's true. You can look that up. Rita Return. Computer engineer. Sure I am, but I'm not going to lunch with anyone who doesn't respect a novice. And you know what? You did fine. Now let's get after this Blackie Power Out jerk before he causes any more trouble. That was the hot beginning of the Power Out case. We finally got our man, but that's another story. Alright, well, we've learned a lot here. And I think this knowledge will be very helpful for battling our modern computer woes. But now we get to enjoy a fun game. In a moment. Oh boy, welcome to the Inside Story game. The object is to land on each computer topic and answer a question on that topic correctly. If you land between topics, you'll be asked a trivia question just for fun. Once you answer all the computer questions, you'll get a crack at the master question, the toughest test of all. Ooh, master question. Oh man, if you're familiar with my previous work, you all know how much I like computer board games. Also, it rolled by itself. That was rude. I wasn't ready to roll yet. Okay, which way do I want to go? If I go left, I'll land on create. And if I go right, then we'll also land on create, so I suppose it doesn't matter. What information do you use to create? What do you use to create information when you use your computer? Oh, man. That's a trick question. I mean, you type in the information on the keyboard, but you also use the monitor to see what you're typing. I'm going to go with keyboard. Oh, awesome. Okay, this time it let me roll. Oh, so it marked off create. That's one question down. So if I go left, I'll land on a random trivia question, and I'll land on a different question if I go the other way. What kind of birds were cartoon characters Heckle and Jekyll? I believe they were crows. But isn't blackbirds another name for crows? Or a colloquial name? Well, darn. Well, if I go down and land on create, which I already have, so... How far is it to Tipperary? I believe it's a long, long way. Of course, these questions don't count for anything. They're just for fun. Save. When you save information, where is it put? Oh, obviously. On disk. Oh, either way. All roads lead to load. When you load something into the computer, where does it go? To RAM, of course. Ooh, start up or modify. When you start up your computer, where is the program put? Seems very similar to the question for load, but it's put into RAM. Hey Grib, welcome. Let's see. Already did create. Let's do a fun question. What's the southernmost state? I actually just had this question the other day when I was playing Trivial Pursuit with some friends. Well, I didn't have the question, but I know the answer is Hawaii. Let's see. Fun question or one I already have? Do a fun question. Oh man, it's already repeating them? Lame. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Modify. There we go. Alright, last one, and then we get to answer the master question. What information can't you modify? Information in ROM. Because it is read only. Oh boy. Put the following steps in order to reach the computer master level. Well, first thing you do is start up. Second thing you do is load. Third thing you do is modify. Last thing you do is save. I'm on the road to becoming a real computer wizard. Alright, well, that was the inside story. I hope this has given you all some insight into our current computer crisis. So I think the best way to protect yourself against Spectre and Meltdown is to, save frequently. Make sure you save every 10 minutes or so. You don't want Blackle Powerman, whatever his name was, to come along and turn your computer off and make you lose all your work. So, just diligent computer hygiene and you are on your way. Let's check back in with our friend computer. I'm going to load up a program here which will allow me to communicate with them. This is a program called Fire Organ. And this may have been the first ever screensaver. Although its purpose wasn't really to save the screen, per se. It's mostly just, neat graphical effects. So 1 through 9 and A through Z will load some pretty intense patterns onto the screen. That was 1, this is 2. This was pretty impressive at the time. A lot of math going on. Oh, apparently Q doesn't do anything? Wait, it's at A through Z, right? I don't know. It's giving me errors all of a sudden. Well, let's read the instructions. See if I can figure out what's going on here. This demo album was released into the public domain in August of 1981 to raise visibility of the art form of visual composition. The visual scores are the original. Only the documentation has been updated and changed slightly for inclusion in shareware libraries. Unlike other shareware software, this demo album is free. Free in quotes. So, you know. Trust that as much as you feel like you can. I hope you enjoy it. Brooke W. Boring? Software author. That's what I should start calling myself. Hi, I'm Matt. I'm a software author. It's intended to run with a minimum of information shown at initial boot up. Enjoyment of Fire Organ is largely a matter of mood and music. Select the music and adjust your TV for the brightness, contrast, and tint you find most comfortable. Spacebar will always freeze the picture. Paddles are very desirable, of course, I agree. I think any sensible person would. Each of the buttons has a key equivalent. Right, so you can use the buttons on the paddle or joystick to manipulate things. For scores A through J, only pot zero controls the relative speed. Oh, you can affect the speed? Ooh, special effects. Hey, Levant. Yeah, pot readings were pretty high for this program. Bring a particular score into execution. Comma, period, and slash will randomly select a new score. Oh, cool. One of three graphics composers represented in this release of Fire Organ. Some meta documentation here. Some documentation about the documentation. I've taken this opportunity to say some things about myself and Vagabondo Enterprises, which may be of some interest. This free sample is our way of introducing this exciting new art form. Random number generators are slippery. Yeah. Fire Organ is stuffed full of intelligent defaults that ensure continuity under most every condition. It has not, however, been tested in all possible combination of apples and might not work at all on some special configurations. So, the old version of this software is provided, you know, without warranty, use at your own risk. Repeating the boot up menu. Okay. I still don't know why some of the keys aren't working here. Oh, I bet it's because I'm not using caps. Of course. This program was written in 1981. That was before capital letters were invented. Okay. Now it's working the way it's supposed to. So let's see, I can increase the speed of some of these. Right just sort of resets it. Maybe I should have read the documentation a little bit more closely. Ooh, Starfield. In both senses of the word. So yeah, some neat stuff going on here. But let's check back in with our buddy. Hey, computer, how's it going? It went okay. I think we learned a lot about computers. I've learned the value of saving my work frequently. Yeah, it didn't tell us about that. I mean, it said I'm basically a computer wizard, so I think that's pretty much all I needed to know. Okay, well, maybe I'll find a book on it or something. Okay, well, I don't think that's necessary, but thank you for your input. Don't worry, folks. Computer's okay. They're just taking a little nap. Let's see. What else did I want to play in today's stream? Okay, here we go. Oops. It's freaking out because I replaced the disk before it was finished loading stuff. Oh, that was a basic program? Weird. Yeah, that must just be for the for loading the binary subroutines. Oh, right. I replaced the disk. That makes sense. So this is a program called Raster Blaster. This is a pinball simulation from 1981. Why do I play this? Nostalgia? Partially nostalgia. I played the stuff when I was a kid, when I had an Apple II, and partly because I thought it might be of interest to some other people, you know? See how things used to be back before the Intel processor, back before continuous internet connection, and back in the good old days of computers. And also because some of the stuff just hasn't been documented. Last time I checked, there wasn't a video of the inside story on YouTube, so now there is, or there will be, as soon as I upload it to YouTube. Let's see, what were the keys here? All right. You can like control the velocity of Oh. Why didn't it bounce off? Yeah, like you can control the velocity of the ball launcher. I'm not sure what it actually. Yeah, when I was a kid and I played this, are there any RPGs or games where you have to shoot, kill, hack stuff? Oh, yeah, absolutely. There were a ton of RPGs that originated on the Apple II. Well, maybe not a ton, but. Ultima and Wizardry, which became two of the most important RPGs, got their start on the Apple II. I didn't have those, of course, but I will be taking a look at an RPG that's not quite as famous as Ultima or Wizardry, but still pretty interesting in its own right. Boy, I'm hitting those gutters just, every single time. So yeah, when I first played this game, I did not see why it was good because I was a teenager. I had played Alien Crush or Devil's Crush or whatever the Genesis version of that game was called. Which was an excellent video game pinball game. So when I discovered this game, I was like, well, this is boring. It's just one screen. It's not. I mean, it's like a real pinball table. Well, why would I want to play that? But when this game came out, people really weren't making games for this computer that had physics. It was super hard to do. And then Bill Budge came along and he figured out how to do it. Now, the physics aren't perfect, but it's a hell of a lot closer to pinball than a lot of other attempts were, I'm sure. And Bill Budge would later go on to make the pinball construction kit for EA, which is his most famous work, which was, I forget what system that was for. It might have been, I think that was after the Apple II. Oh yeah, Might and Magic 1. Yeah, Might and Magic also got it started on the Apple II. I don't know if that was the original platform, but there were definitely versions of all of those games for the Apple II. But yeah, we take advantage of things like physics today in video games. But this was sort of the Half-Life 2 of its day. Which is a weird thing to say, but like, people hadn't seen video games that had this kind of realistic physics to it, so people were excited. It does seem a little It seems a little bonkers to me that this was the only table for the game. I mean, I would think that once you have the physics engine down, you know, that's the hard part. You can design a whole bunch more tables with just different layouts of bumpers and different, you know, different environments, different rule sets. But this was the only table you had. This table was Raster Blaster. So yeah, I need to enable my controller real quick, because okay. So yeah, when you have the controller enabled, you can actually like put a little bit of spin on it or something. I'm not really sure what exactly. Of course, then I have the controller in my hands, which doesn't make quite as much sense for flippers. Well, I don't know. It's the A and B on the controller. Oh, I think I chose a hard game the first time instead of the easy game. That's why those gutters weren't. That's why the safety springs weren't activated. So yeah, flipping the flippers also changes the position of those lights up there at the top. And if you lay all of them up, it gives you a letter. And I'm not sure what happens when you get both, because I'm terrible at pinball. So I guess you can play four players. Or maybe that's just the high score list. Okay, how do I select? Budge Co. It's a pretty good name. Also, Raster Blaster is a pretty good name for a video game. I wonder if this game has like a tilt functionality. Like, I wonder if this is like nudging the table a little bit. I don't think so. I think it's just for the English on the initial launch. I always wondered why you wouldn't just always hit both paddles at once. Doesn't seem to be a downside to it, especially on a real pinball table. You know, just hit both of them just to be safe. I mean, why not? But yeah, this was entertainment in 1981, so be thankful for what you have. I don't know how I managed to choose a hard game the first time around. Also, no hacker intro on this disc, which is interesting. Alright, how do I... Oh, just the arrow keys. Weird. Oh, you can also increase the number of players with the arrow keys. Okay. That's cool. So I guess four players can huddle around the Apple II and take turns and see who can get the highest score. Oh, and of course, it's the hard game, so no gutter bumpers. Well, there's probably some way to activate them, maybe by lighting up all six of those down at the bottom. Let's see, I have another pinball game on here, I think. Let me see. Oh yeah, here we go. This one is a little bit later by a different developer, but this is Night Mission. This one actually has a theme, which is nice. The theme is dropping bombs, presumably on innocent civilians. Oh, and it has an arcade metaphor where you put in quarters. It's kind of nice. Load yourself up on credits. There we go. Alright, so yeah, this has the... You can adjust the tension of the spring. This makes a little bit more sense than Raster Blaster. Like you're actually adjusting how far down the spring recoils. A lot more video gamey sound effects in this one too. You can just barely nudge the ball. Never heard of Sublogic before. I don't know if they did anything else. Oops. I should probably go back to using the keyboard. Ball seems like it can move quite a bit faster in this one. And it has sort of a nice trail behind it. To make it easier to track. I can't tell if the physics are as realistic as Raster Blaster because the ball is just bouncing around a little bit too fast to get a sense for what the gravity's like and everything. But it's definitely more action-packed than Raster Blaster. Need to look up Sublogic and see if they did anything else. The paddle physics doesn't feel quite right. Feels a little mushy compared to Raster Blaster. Oops. Oh, okay, so when you die, you have a chance of getting a free extra life if down in the bottom right, well, on the left column there, down next to the credits, it says match. And if that number matches the last two numbers of your score, then you get a free life. Which is the sort of thing a lot of real pinball games do. Much better sound effects in this one. Much better sense of speed. Yeah, they really improved on the design of Raster Blaster. It's kind of cool that you can just keep mashing the credits button and just keep adding credits. You usually don't see that sort of thing in these older games. You know, they want to make it feel, you know, like an authentic arcade experience. No one has 99 quarters to put into an arcade machine or a pinball. Dang it. Do I like pinball IRL? I mean, I'll play it if there's a pinball machine there. I don't dislike it. I'm not good at it, as you can tell. Oh man, look at... Oh my god. It is just hitting that bumper at the exact right angle to just slam it down that middle gutter. Every time. Alright, so if the match is a 30, nope. Of course, putting 99 credits in doesn't really do you any good, because it's not like you can continue. You just, you know, you can't hold on to the score that you had. You just get to play again. Are pinball machines common in the U.S.? They used to be. Definitely not so common anymore. The movie theater in the city where I live still has a couple pinball machines, I think. And that's the only place I've really seen them in a long time. I think they're more difficult to maintain than arcade machines just because of all the moving components. Although, with arcade machines, you have a bunch of electrical issues you have to take into consideration. I wonder if there's a way to adjust your starting tension without a joystick or paddles, because a lot of people didn't have any back then. They just had to make do with the keyboard. Dang it. Yeah, arrow keys don't do anything. Plus or minus? No. Wait, I did something that caused the ball to, like, move a little bit, I think. Okay. Oh, so this one does have the tilt mechanic. Interesting. So, if your ball gets stuck, you can, you know, simulate actually tilting the pinball machine to get your ball unstuck. But if you do it too many times, then it enables the tilt mode, which disables your paddles, you know, because you don't want people to cheat or mess up the machine. That's interesting that it also disables all the sound effects. Alright, so, nope, no match, no free game. Oh well. So that was pinball. Those were the two pinball games that I had. There might have been more that I'm not sure of. Let's see. So there was an official version of Defender on the Apple II, but that's not the version that I had. I had this very... Oops. That's the... That's the right game, but the wrong disc. Let's see. Which disc was it? I think it was this. Okay. I'll explain what all that text was about here in a second. I don't know why it puts all that garbage on the screen before it loads. So this is a homebrew version of Defender, written by a guy named Joe Holt. With a very fancy signature here. Aw. Dedicated to Kathy. Alright, so the controls in this are a little weird. So, I mean, I guess it's not weird considering scrolling games barely existed at the time, but like, if I nudge the joystick left, your ship turns around and just kind of floats over to the left side of the screen. Or no, nudge right and it floats left. What's more common in the US, parsley or coriander? I'm not really sure. I'd say probably parsley. When I was a kid, parsley was always on the spice rack, and I didn't really know what coriander was until I got a little bit older and I started eating, like, authentic Mexican and Indian food. So yeah, probably parsley. Also, it was in that song, Parsley, Sage, Rosemary, and Thyme. So this is a pretty good game, and this is a pretty decent version of the game. Again, I'm not very good at it. I like this laser. It's just, it's like a railgun. You just tap the button and it's just this line of death that goes all the way across the screen. Very satisfying to use. So this alien over here is trying to abduct one of my friends. So, man, that UFO that comes is just brutal. I don't know what I'm supposed to do about it. Well, I guess I'm supposed to kill it, but easier said than done. So, the object of the game is to kill all of the alien spaceships, of course, but if you want to go for a high score, you want to wait for the alien to, or one of the alien ships to make a move. Okay, so that little sound effect you heard was a ship trying to abduct one of the people I'm trying to save. So, luckily it's very slow, so all I have to do is... Oh, no! Okay. So you get an extra 500 points for rescuing and dropping off your people. I'm not sure... Hell, that actually helps them, though. I mean, it's not like Choplifter. Like, I can't take them into my ship and carry them off to safety. So they're just always at risk of abduction. And if an alien ship manages to... Oh, what? I totally blew that up before it got to me. Ooh. Nice little rendition of oops. I was listening to the song and I didn't put my initials in. That was Beethoven, right? I forget which of Beethoven's things It wasn't the fifth. Beethoven's fifth is the one that goes like da 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 da. But it's something by Beethoven. Also, I didn't use my bombs at all. I have 3 bombs that blow up everything on the screen, which is probably a good tactic to use when the UFO attacks me. Screen wrapped around from left to right. Might have been the first game ever to have like a mini map. I'm not sure. If your aim is bad, you can kill the person while they are dangling from the ship, which sucks for them. But yeah, if the ship manages to get a person to the top of the screen, then they become like a super badass that just hunts you down relentlessly. See if I can beat a level here. Attack wave 1 completed. You do get a bonus for having alive people. I don't think you actually lose if they all get abducted, but it would be very hard to win with all of those super ships flying around. You have a volcano spewing some sort of particles. Do these kill me? Weird. Yeah, I don't know how authentic this is or how close to the arcade version of Defender it is, because this is the only version of Defender I really played a lot. Oh, cool. The ships blow up when they get near the volcano, too. What's this thing? Oh, what? It exploded into a bunch of little things. That was the smart bomb, as it was known as. Man, I do not remember this music here. That's me, Duck. Okay, so that was Defender. But the main reason I wanted to play this was to show off something that happened every now and then when you have an old computer and a big old box of pirated discs. So, you notice how there was a little text prompt there down in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen before everything went black? Whenever you see that, that means that the Hello program is written in BASIC rather than assembly or assembler. And Hello is, you know, whatever program is named Hello, that's the program that runs when you boot the disk up. It's kind of like the autorun.ini of its day. So when you see that little prompt, you know that means you can press Ctrl-C to break the program. And you can see, that's it. That's the whole program. It's just a command to automatically, brun, which is the command to run a binary program, and then Defender. So, once I discovered that, I can get in here and see what else was on this disk. There's some other stuff on there, so let's see what it is. You are hereby given permission to copy this disk to your heart's delight. This game is not copy protected and is not being sold. It is public domain. Why? There are several reasons. I personally think that the price of games these days is outrageous. We don't have the $40 to spend on games that aren't even worth the disc they're put on. I'm not going to contribute to that. I don't think the copyright laws of this land are too hot either. For example, if I did want to sell my Defender, I'd have to sell it through Sirius, which owns the audiovisual rights to Defender for the Apple. However, they do not own the name. However, the name Defender, Atari does. But it'll be a cold day in hell before Atari sells an Apple game. Poor me, I just wanted to sell Defender for the Apple. A legal catch-22. Finally, I'm not really out to make a buck. I have faith in the American way. I really do. But it'll take a while, and I want to do my part, however small it may be. Let the software companies know, we will not be ripped off. I have some ideas for a new type of computer business. Revolutionary, I think. A co-op, if you will. Everyone contributes, everyone publishes software or designs hardware, everyone gets profits, and everyone who sells something through the co-op will become members, and the members will be the ones who made the decisions, not some figurehead president. I know the idea is old, isn't it called a democracy? But with advanced communications techniques, a free modem network for all members to brainstorm, etc., I think it could work, and I'm willing to try. Alright, so even if you couldn't care less, go ahead and play the game. Have fun, and I hope to see something of yours someday. Very sincerely, Joe Holt. ACPC Gamer. $40 for these kind of games sounds crazy. Yeah. Even at the time, even if I was using, you know, if I grew up in the era of the Apple II, I would not see the appeal of paying $40 for, you know, an arcade game. I mean, you know, it was a different culture back then, and I guess putting quarters into an arcade machine was a lot more common, but I don't know. Like, there's only so much Donkey Kong or so much Defender you can play. But yeah, for 12 or 13 year old me, you know, however old I was, you know, breaking into the disc and finding the secret message from the person who made the game was really cool. You don't really get that kind of experience these days. Also, there are a few programs related to Defender on here. Get high scores into memory. Oh, it doesn't have my high score. Yeah, Might and Magic 1. A lot of the RPGs probably would have been worth it to a lot of people. I would be more likely to play those than Defender. I wonder if the disc is copy protected. I don't even know how to check that on the emulator. Oh well. Anyway, see, the version I loaded up before had see, it has the message before the game starts, so I wanted to show you the way that I experienced it, where I sort of stumbled upon the message by hacking into the disc. Also, the version of the disc that I had, on side B, it had a bunch of other programs that the author wrote. Not really games, most of them were like little graphics demos, but also very, very cool. Let's see. Well, since we have Koss in the chat room asking about RPGs, let me load up the one RPG that I played on the Apple II. Or the closest thing I had to an RPG, anyway. I had a big old box of pirated discs, but no Wizardry, no Ultima, no Might and Magic. What I had was Adventure to Atlantis. Copyright 1982 by Synergistic Software, so a year after Ultima came out. Also, I looked it up, and apparently Adventure is a deliberate spelling. I guess because it was for the Apple. You know, Adventure, Apple Adventure. I don't really get it. But yeah, these are some pretty amazing graphics. And this game actually does some really neat stuff. It was just completely inscrutable to me at the time. New game or old? Let's see if there's an old game on here. Oh no, it just started a new game, even though I pressed O. You are the High One of the Kingdom of the Sargolo. See, since it's in graphical text rather than text mode, it can fake lowercase letters, which was nice. You are in your palace on the Isle of Lepore. The kingdom is in great danger, and only you can save it. You must learn about this peril and find the way to resolve it. During your quest, you can press ? For a list of commands. Throughout, all inputs are limited to 20 characters or less. After you leave Lepore, you can save your game. Only the characteristics of your party, your spells, and your general location are saved. By what name or title do you wish to be addressed? It's both a name and a title. Also, look at the responsiveness of the keys. That's a lot better than the most graphical text interfaces of the time. So when I saw this, I was like, hell yeah, I know what this is. This is a fucking RPG. You know, this is like D&D. You have stats between 8 and 18 instead of 3 and 18, which is nice. Ooh. This is actually a really good roll. I want to say this is satisfactory. What is my reaction time? 0 through 9, where 0. my reaction time is none. I guess I'll go with 5. My alignment, -5 to 5, where negative is chaotic while positive is lawful. Oh shoot, my caps lock key just came off my keyboard. That's weird. I guess I was a little bit too enthusiastic when I toggled it. Let's go 0. I'm neutral. Do I want the decoder ring? Well, if you're giving me the option, I don't see why not. Oh, it's a handicap. Well, okay, I'll take it. You're in your throne room. On the table, there is an orb, a note, and a book. Commands are go, north, southeast, or west, or castle, read, take, offer. Okay. Yeah, this is starting to come back to me. Take, orb. Can I examine the orb? Oh, look. Oh. I guess it's not letting me look. Do I have to go into my inventory? You currently have an orb. I only have the decode spell. I'm not sure why it won't let me look. Oh, it's probably just look around you. Look at the room. Can I use the orb? Using your orb does no good here. Alright. So this is sort of a weird pseudo strategy game. You have to write the commands down on paper so you don't forget it. I mean, you can just hit ? Anytime and see what the commands are. Oops. I guess my score is -20 because I took the decoder ring handicap. And here's my stats. Oh, mighty High One, you must help us. The kingdom is infested with all manner of dire creatures. From where are these fearsome beasts coming? You must find a way to stop them. Please help us. The book can only be read by wizards. It contains the spells Detect Aura, Magic Detect, Divination, Enchant, and Panic Horn. You are in the Oracle's chambers. Do you wish to consult the Oracle? The monsters in your kingdom are being brought here by your enemies. Watch the wall behind me and you shall see. Ooh, a magic television. This is a remote section of your island. Even now, an enemy is approaching. And it's pooping all over us. As you can see, a flying mechanism of some kind is landing on our island and releasing monsters. They are from Atlantis. You must gather a force of wizards, travel to Atlantis, and stop these invaders before they reduce the kingdom to ruins and conquer us. You must know, however, Atlantis is an island and it cannot be approached by sea. It is ringed by impassable reefs. I can help you know more. You are in the Oracle Chambers. There's nobody to offer anything to. Well, there's the Oracle. The captain of the guard sent up 5 guards. You now have 5. Okay. Oh, so I have 5 fighters now. Weird. Oh, it's just saying the same thing again. Okay. Well, this is a good time for a short restroom break. I will be back momentarily. In the meantime, enjoy this show from the Oracle. Oh no, I think my internet connection just died. Okay, it says OBS reconnected. Hopefully you're still able to see me. Let me wait. Okay. Yes. Oh, excuse me. Yeah, I really need to get a longer Ethernet cable so I can just wire my connection, you know, have a wire connection to the internet. Glorious 3-color graphics, says CPC Gamer. Thank you, Grib. Okay, so the Oracle didn't have anything else to say. Nothing else going on in this room. Let's head back south. Alright, so I read the note, can't read the book. Well, I do have the decode spell. Oops, wrong button. How do I use the spell? Use decode. I don't have the decode. Wizards? I don't have any wizards. Okay, well, let's just exit the throne room then. Which means I want to go west. Oh, right. Oh, boy. So, yeah, this is... Again, this is pre-arrow keys, so... If you want to move around the map, You gotta do it the old-fashioned way. So once I got to this point, I had no idea what to do. There doesn't appear... Okay. I've encountered a sorcerer's apprentice. There's no talk command. I think... Okay. So, if I offer the apprentice the book, or not the book, but offer him or her a spell from the book, he accepts your offer and will join you. What name should he use during your journey? Limiting characters. Okay, well, since Grib was the one who requested or asked about role-playing games, he gets the honor of being my first apprentice. Oh, there's one of those monster birds. I don't know if there's anything on the map to check out. Offer magic detect. All right. Wizard number two. I have Grib and Andy. Grib knows detect aura. Andy knows magic detect. There I go, thinking I can use the arrow keys. Like a sucker. What's with this black tree over here? I'm in the forest on Lepore. Morale minus two. Why is my alignment minus two? I haven't done anything evil. Oh wait, my alignment is still zero. I guess the party's total alignment is minus two. Six monsters? Holy crap. Well, I do have five fighters. So, this is the intricate combat system. So, they've killed three of my fighters, I've killed two of them. Hey, up. Oh, looks like a stalemate there. So, when all of your fighters are dead, you just run back to the castle automatically. I already have a full complement of guards, so five is the most you can have. I think I technically... My score is technically higher than it was before. My alignment and morale are the same. I don't know if there's any actual penalty for... losing all of your fighters. Where the wizard's just standing there and doing nothing. Well, the only spells that they know are detect aura and detect magic, so I don't think they would have been much help in a fight. Strength of 10. Alright. That fight went a lot better for me. All of the monsters are dead. My score slowly going up. Can I summon more fighters, or do I have to be... Yeah, I have to go back to the castle if I want to summon more people. I mean, I'm pretty close anyway, so... Might as well do that. Oh, you can just hit E for exit instead of going west every time. Maybe I should go up to where these monsters are being dropped. Not now, they might see us. We need some fireballs. I don't think my spellbook has fireball. Oops. Divination, enchant, and panic horn. I wonder if that was supposed to be a really bad rendition of Beethoven's Fifth. Five monsters with a strength of 9. I like those odds. Hey, look at that. Only one loss. So eventually, I figured out that what you're supposed to do is just wander around the island until you happen to bump into enough apprentices to offer all of your spells. Okay, what's the next spell? Divination. Offer divination. Accept your offer and we'll join you. Let's see. Anyone else in the chat who would like to be one of my party members? Speak up now. Or forever hold your peace. I don't have a list of the people chatting. Oh wait, Levant was here earlier. I don't know if he's still hanging out, but oh, you're already in the party, CPC Gamer. You have magic detect. Press 0 through 3 for spells. Oh, I see. Oh, so I guess every wizard can have 2 spells. Yeah, I used your real name, Andy, instead of CPC Gamer. I hope you don't mind. Can I cast a spell? Using your magic detect does no good here. Well, it does acknowledge that I can use magic detect in that way. You don't have the knife? Okay. So yeah, eventually I will probably have to use magic detect. Alright, so all I have left is enchants and panic horn. Let's see. Don't believe anyone else is hanging out right now, so your name will be Chance the Enchanter. I'm not sure if going into the heart of monster territory is a good idea, but I don't think I can actually die. Sweet. That could not have gone any better. Score is minus 12. Still only level 1. Alright, offer my last spell. Pants the Panic Mage. I don't know. I don't know if I ever figured out what the orb does. I've already given that spell to one of my wizards. Oops. He isn't interested in the decoder. Oh, right. So if they're not interested, they just kind of leave. An orb, a note, and a book. So where is my decoder? I thought it was written somewhere in my stats or in my spell name wizard number. Can I save my game? There's no command for it. Oh wait, I remember. It said that I can save my game once I get off the island, right? Offer orb? Nope, not interested. So now, I just need to wander around a little bit. Until randomly. No, not you. not interested in the book. Yeah, sure, I'll fight some monsters.
Three.
Ooh. They kicked my ass that second round. Okay, well, no biggie. Summon some more fighters. I never checked for, like, secret exits or anything. Does the Oracle have any advice now that I have 5 wizards? Nope, not really. No way to just skip past this either. You just have to watch it again. It's not that remote. It only takes me a couple minutes to get up there. A flying mechanism of some kind. No, Grib. I've not even come close to beating this game. Nice. Well, my overall alignment is 0, so I guess I got some good wizards to balance out the bad ones. Two monsters. Scoff. I don't need any more apprentices. Oh, here we go. There were sounds of terrible fighting in the Ornithopter. All is quiet now. So yes, it took me a very long time of doing trial and error, using every spell in every possible situation before I figured out that I can do this. I do wish to enter the Ornithopter. All is quiet, there are a number of dead men, some weapons, and a control panel. Do I wish to try the controls? Here goes nothing. Alright, so now we get to figure this shit out. legal commands. I don't want to use any illegal commands. Ascend, descend, go, offer, use, instruments, condition, select bombs, wizards, velocity, locator, and quit. Well, I am... Atlantis is not yet in range. Okay, so I'm limited on fuel, but I don't think my fuel was running out when I was looking at the commands. Instruments. I guess it is running. I guess instruments just brings me back to that screen. Condition. Select. Crossbows or ship's guns. Ship's guns at ready. I mean, it's sort of moving by itself. So, I might not... Oh, that's nice. You can hit escape and just pause it. So I guess I can just keep tapping L, and then when Atlantis is in range, I can try to go in that direction, maybe? Oh, so the wind direction is west, so I guess that's why I'm slowly being blown west. I have no idea which direction Atlantis is in. I don't think the Oracle said anything about where Atlantis is, just that it's surrounded by reefs. I think if I run out of fuel, I have to start completely over. Whoa! I hit space and I just fired my gun at something. Maybe if I go west, I can go a little bit faster, maybe. Oh, wait, wasn't there a velocity command? Yeah. V. 5. Whoa. Oh, God, there's a monster there. Go north. There is no warlock. Oh, no, it's a green skull. They're attacking. Oh, God, what do I do? Fuel leak. Oh, no. Set velocity back to 1. The ornithopter was coming from top right. Maybe Atlantis is on the top right. A dragon approaches. I don't know how to aim my gun. Oh, hey, I killed the dragon. All right, well, that's as good a theory as any, cause. So, let's try going northeast. Of course, that would be... It's an air squid. Oh, God. The air squid damaged my speed controller. Quick, get him. It's a cycler. Blew him to pieces. What was my other weapon here? Select. Maybe the crossbows are aimable? Maybe I should just try landing on one of these islands. Okay, that's a good angle. I'm trying to land on this little island. Gargoyles. They look a lot like the rocks. I don't know what to do if they're not coming at me from an angle where I can actually hit them. One of our fighters was killed. I wonder if I'm close enough to the island to descend. Oh, you have safely landed on an island. You are near the entrance to an ancient castle. Do I wish to enter? There is a marooned fighter standing in the entrance. Of course. Okay. I'm in the entry hall. What do I want to do? Go? Okay. Okay, so 1 switches to a wizard, 2 switches to a fighter, I assume. Well, all of my wizards are okay. That's the good news. I'm still not seeing a save command. Well, my score is 10. It's got to count for something. Oh, I probably should have made sure I had 5 fighters before I got on board the ornithopter. I don't know. Are there any exits here? I don't see the west. I wonder if that black bar is supposed to be an exit to the south. So when I press enter, it sort of just puts me in this text-only mode, which is kind of weird. I'm currently carrying nothing. What happened to my orb? Oh, so you can equip and unequip the crossbow. Okay, so I... Oh, okay. I thought that would have just taken me out of the castle. Oops. Yep, that's a bookcase, all right. Move. Bookcase. Take bookcase. No exit. Okay, so if I just look, it backs me out. Nope. Take book. Okay. Well, this is a pretty crappy library. All there is one empty bookcase. Someone fell in. I hear faint moans from the pit trap, or from the pit. I see nothing special. I keep doing G for jit. Yes, jit. G for get instead of T for take. Okay, that doesn't do any good. Oops. The enchantment needs a source of power. Well, I lost my orb. In the dining hall, something is hidden. Okay. Do any of these spells help me rescue the person who fell in the pit? No good. Oh, it won't let me go pit. Well, sorry whoever fell in the pit. Was it one of my people? Yeah, it was one of my fighters. Uh-oh. Oh god, how do I attack? The trog lowered my strength? Oh, so I just attack with space. Am I supposed to be using the joystick here? Arrow keys don't do anything. I think I can save my state. Hold on a sec. Okay. I just wanted to save in case... Oh my god, I am supposed to be using the joystick. Oh wow. I had no idea. This is an action RPG. Is there no way to aim without the joystick? So 1 and 2 switches between wizard and... No, I don't want to quit. Wow, that is so weird. So normally, like, the replacement arrow keys would be IJKL, but those are all, like, actual commands. Yeah, it never once mentioned that I'm supposed to be using a joystick. No wonder I can never beat this game. I bet if I was using my joystick, I could have shot all those enemies when I was flying. So how do I look at... Wait, this is going to be awkward having to switch between the joystick and my keyboard. There must be a PDF manual or something. I don't know. I can check real quick. I found a text file. Let's see. Oh, there are combat spells at some point. Sample Atlantean document. Huh. It's a hybrid game combining the best features of adventure games, arcade games, and fantasy role-playing games. The adventure takes place. I should probably just suspend time real quick. Takes place in the distant past during the mythic days of Atlantis. The game will never be the same when replayed. Oh, so I wonder if the islands are like randomized. Interesting. Since a given game is indeterminately long, it's all up to you. You can save an ongoing game and continue it later. So how do I actually do that? Okay, so it does say you don't need paddles or a joystick. Oh, so if you choose no reaction time, it eliminates the arcade-like aspects altogether. Okay, so when you press Q to quit, you will be given the option to save your game. Okay. Well, it says I can use the left and right arrow keys. Oh, maybe it means the bracket keys. I can't carry the chairs. Oh, that turns the sound off. Weird. It's definitely not left and right. Yeah, the arrow brackets just toggle the sound. I'll just try every key that doesn't seem to do anything. Yeah. Of course, when I was a kid, you know, I didn't have the manual. I had a pirated copy of the game, and that's it. I had to figure everything out on my own. This was about as far as I made it as a kid. I eventually did make it to an island, land, and I wasn't sure what to do after that. I bet the manual will be helpful. You can use either the arrow keys or the game paddle to aim your weapons. Yeah. The arrow keys aren't doing anything. That's weird. Maybe it's because it detects that I have a joystick plugged in that it won't let me use the arrow keys. Okay, well, whatever. I can keep playing now. I don't know how to tell it that I went to look at that little thing. The north. Well, look harder. I mean, that could just be just a graphical glitch. It's interesting that it has a randomized element. Oh god. Okay. Nope. No, it got me before I could grab the joystick. I should probably, if I play this again, I should probably turn the reaction speed down to 0 just so I don't have to worry about that. Maybe Can I just disable the joystick? No, arrow key still won't do anything. I could use the number pad as the joystick. That's one of the options the emulator has. Oh wait, I can use the cursor keys. Oh wait, no. You don't get the analog. You know, the analog control when you do that. What about the number pad? No. See, it just goes from the farthest left to the farthest right. There's no... I mean, I assume that whatever the keyboard controls are gives you finer control over your aim. But I don't know why. Alright, I'm going to set my joystick right next to the keyboard. Like, in a better position. Nope. That's definitely a table, not a counter. What's that thing to the right of the door? Oh wait, didn't it say there was a secret in the dining hall? Against the door, you can see a rope. Oh my gosh. So that was a thing. I rescued my man. Awesome. Against the wall, you can see a rod. Using your rod doesn't do any good here. Story of my life. Okay, so I just needed to look at the wall. But in this room, I see nothing special. Oh, look at that. I can see a scroll. See? You gotta try stuff. There's nothing on the scroll to read. Okay, so it's just a blank scroll. Moving a piano is hard. There are people whose job is entirely just moving pianos. In the windowed hall, something is hidden. I still have my rope. That's nice. What are my other spells? Is this a magic piano? No. Right, I need a source of power. So there's a secret in the windowed hall. Oh, I bet that's a window. No, maybe not. My candle is lit, okay. I don't know what word it wants me to say for the thing to the right of the door. If anyone has any suggestions, I wouldn't mind them. All right, Grib. I'll do my best. Good luck with the games. The chapel. You know, when everything looks like when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. When all you have is this list of commands, everything looks like something that you should move. That looks kind of like a book to me. Oh, I wonder. Hold on. Nope. Hi. The wizard won't let me. I tried to say. Offer. He accepted my gift and left. Wait. Oh, so I guess I gave him one use of the spell. Because it used to be 20 and now it's 19. I wanted to see if I could go. Okay, so I guess that was a stairway down. Why won't the wizard just let me talk? Should I just try to attack the wizard? The wizard won't let me look. Okay. Okay, I guess that was a bad idea. I just lost one of my fighters. So do I just need to offer him a spell every time? I guess I should use that one because that's the one I have the most of. Okay, so again in the windowed hall. Yeah, I never seem to be able to move anything more than once. I know I don't have the bed. I want to take a nap. Ooh. Nice. You know what would make more sense than trying to use my Xbox controller? I just thought of this. I can totally just use the mouse. Yeah, look at that. I'm waving that sucker around like nobody's business. I'm in the baths. I can't carry it anymore. Well, why not? I have five wizards with me. I guess a lamp seems better than a candle. Doesn't do any good. Yeah, apparently that thing is supposed to be a staircase, which you could have fooled me. Oh God. Yes. I can't carry the shield. Well, why the heck not? I'm out of arrows. No. I do see the arrow. I see four of them, five of them. Oh my God. Well, I'm boned. Now that is a staircase. That is clearly a staircase going up. I don't know what that thing is supposed to be. Wait, I thought it was out of arrows. Okay. Oh, maybe you can only use a certain number of arrows on each screen. That's weird. I wish I knew what these monsters were called so I could search them. That might not be a thing, though. Yeah, I don't know what the thing sitting in front of the chapel is. Box? Or not the chapel, the altar. Right, see you later, CPC Gamer. Thanks for hanging out. Your character survived, at least so far. Better than we can say for FTL. Putting candles on altars is a thing, isn't it? Well, I don't have my candle anymore. Grand Hall. Pillared Hall. Windowed Hall. Okay, so this is where there's a secret, right? Okay, shovel, definitely a thing that I want. Especially since I don't know what the rod is supposed to do. It's probably like an adventure game where each of these items has one specific use. Any more secrets? In the guard room. This is a pretty big castle. I guess it makes sense. Most castles are big. Yes, take the Wom de Bois. I haven't found anything resembling fuel, which is worrying. Let's see, reception. I mean, I guess that's just a randomly generated bookcase that doesn't have anything on it. I need to find the guard room. Whoop! Someone is trapped in the rubble. Oh, okay. Oh, good thing I found that shovel. That was convenient. Yeah, I want to try using that candle on the altar. I don't know how to tell the game that I want to do that. Oops. Nope. Aw, man. Yeah, once that thing starts moving, I can't do anything about it. Ooh. Why not? Let's see. I mean, I probably won't need the rope again, right? Since I already dealt with the pit trap. Using it doesn't do any good. Okay, all these weapons and not a damn thing I can do with any of them. Great. Nope. Nice. And what does it mean exactly when it says I'm losing strength? Oops. I don't know how to get to the thing where it shows my stats. I used to be able to press enter and it shows my stats instead of just my party members and stuff. I guess it's mine. Wisdom, intelligence, strength. Okay, so it's actually reducing my strength stat. I wonder if that's a permanent thing. And seems to anticipate a lot of the words that I'm trying. That's kind of cool. Right, I don't have the rod anymore. So it's probably going to come down to just trying every item in every location, right? Well, okay, that lights my candle. But what good does that do me? If these rooms are randomly generated, then I might be trying to apply logic. I can't leave. My levitation plates aren't charged yet. Okay, so I take that to mean that I haven't accomplished whatever my goal in this castle is. Shoot. Yeah, I definitely need to do a lower reaction time. Okay, so there's no way to unlight the candle. All I can do is light it. Oops. Okay, so I thought I might just drop the candle on the altar. Can I offer something to the altar? No. I'm running out of places to try. Okay. I thought maybe if I was actually aiming at the wizard when I tried to attack him. So yeah, I'm down to my last fighter. That could be bad. I can't go, I can't say, I can't even look. Oh, maybe I just need to try using magic detect in every single room. So this is still going to say something about a guard room, right? Yeah, but I haven't found a guard room yet. Well, what other spells do I have? Oh, you know what? I remember what Detect Aura does. It shows you, like, if you are talking to a wizard or something. Oops, I'm boned. I think it tells you what their alignment is. Okay, I'm going to drop a shovel on the assumption that I already triggered the event that I need the shovel for. Because I want to try something with a scroll. Maybe it's a scroll that contains a piece of music. Okay, I wasn't optimistic about that. I wonder what it means by a source of power. Would an altar be a source of power? Nope. Oh, you smart ass. Okay, so yeah, it shows you their stats. I don't think there's any way to actually recruit them, though. At least not in the castle. The wizard just wants me to... Wizard won't let me read. All I can do is offer or use. It seems to be my only options right now. Whoa, another one? Weird. I have a source of power. The sun. Wait. I don't know if I ever tried to enchant while I have the rod. No. Not a plutonium rod. I thought maybe it might be a plutonium rod. Whoa, can you just run from them? That's cool. Of course, then I won't get all that sweet experience. 22. Wow. So yeah, good old adventure games. Nope. Just try everything, and then after you do that, try everything again. On everything else. It's dropping some of my keystrokes because I'm getting ahead of myself. Excuse me. Whoa. I'm very excited. This is the most progress I've ever made in this game. I'm still kind of stuck, though. You don't see the rope. It's up there. Oh, right. I don't have the staff. Maybe I should try using panic horn the next time I have to talk to a wizard or a monster. Oh. I hope there's not a really obvious exit that I've just been missing. Nope. Don't do that. Can't go down into the pit. Nope, that doesn't help. I guess if I didn't have all of my wizards, then I could recruit them that way. Oops. I wonder what happens when I run out of uses for a spell. Oops. Nope, that didn't... The monster did not care. Uh-oh, I'm out of fighters. All I have is a wizard, and none of my spells are the hurdy kind of spells. My levitation plates aren't charged. Well, I am baffled. In the guard room. Does it mean the room with all the weapons? Is that the guard room? They didn't call it the guard room. Yes, it's just the weapons hall. There's one thing I didn't try. I didn't try using the rope on the pit after I rescued the person. Nope, can't fight you anymore. Sorry, friend. Whatever you are. Nope, doesn't do any good. As I should have expected. How do I charge my levitation plates? Oh. Do I like... Oh. So you have to press P, and then that either disables or enables paddles. So I can use the arrow keys to aim now. That's very strange. It does not say I can do that. Maybe I should just try every key. No smart-ass response. Well, I think I am reaching point of no return. Yeah, so when you use go, it has to be one of the directions. So I can't say, like, go alter or something. Oops. Well, next time I play this, I know that I should just lower the reaction speed and use, you know, press P to use the keyboard instead of the paddles. I mean, even if I had landed on this island with full stock of warriors and plenty of fuel, I wouldn't know how to get out of this castle. I don't know what I need to do. Wait. Why does it say one of the commands is return? Or just does read? I'm sure the reason the game was designed like this was so when I do randomly stumble across the thing I'm supposed to do, I feel pretty smart. Or I feel like, oh, thank God, that's over. Damn it. Stupid wizard. Gift. Yeah, right. Quote unquote gift. All right, well, I think that'll about do it for Adventure to Atlantis. I wish I could figure this game out. Some stuff about it seems cool. But I've done just about everything I can think of. And I don't know what I'm supposed to do. So, maybe I will come back to this game and try a different island. Or maybe I will read the manual and see if it has any additional hints. Read the manual more thoroughly, I mean. I mean, I would have gotten, you know, hours and hours of enjoyment out of this game. Well, I guess that's not true because I had this game. And I guess I did get a few hours trying to figure out what to do. But I did give up on it eventually. And it looks like I'm giving up on it again. Boy, I'm almost out of enchant. Oh, I guess that beep was a warning that I ran out. Codes will be readable next time. The heck does that mean? I just remembered I had that thing. I haven't seen anything that looks like a code. Wait, what? Oh, I looked at the lamp. I think that has to be like the magic genie style lamp, right? There's no rub command. I can't move the lamp because I'm holding it. That's so helpful. Thank you so much. Maybe I need to use an item while I'm looking at another item. Maybe if I have the rope. Or maybe if I have the candle and the lamp. Okay, so we can't use the candle to light the lamp. Oh, I don't have the ring. You use the candle to burn the scroll. Oops. Use the scroll to rub the lamp. I have no idea if I'm even on the right path. I don't know if using one item with another thing is something you can actually do. I'm done. Totally done with this game. I'm gonna quit any minute now. Doing so badly, my score went back down below zero. Yeah, so this game is inscrutable. But that's okay. We have fun, sort of, trying to figure this out. I guess I'll about do it for the night. Thanks everyone for watching. I played a lot more Adventure to Atlantis than I planned to. This is a really fascinating game. I just wish... That's weird. I just wish it was a little bit easier to figure out. So yeah, there's no basic hello program. I was going to see if there was anything else on the disc, like any sort of manual or something. I mean, I doubt it, but give it a shot. Ooh, what the hell? Okay, so there's a text file called Clues, which I don't know how to read that. There's a map file, an object file. Huh. Error number 13. Yep, that seems... pretty standard. I don't know what the deal is with the flashing arrows pointing at LC. Let's see what it does. Nope. Oops. Okay, well, I guess that's what I should have expected. Oh, there we go. Now we're hacking. Wait, that's not supposed to work when I have this weird prompt that I don't know what it does. Oh, am I, like, in the assembly language? It's so weird. Why does it change every time I press enter? Well, great. Well, my computer hacking skills have not made this any easier. Also, I'm in this weird inverse text mode. I have no idea why. Computers used to be really weird. I guess they still are. Alright, I'm gonna do one more thing before I call it. How to read text files. Let's see. Opens a text file for reading. Okay. I'm probably going to have to load the master disk back up, because I'm sure I just messed a lot up. Okay. Nope. Yeah, the file's not locked. Like, I think it's doing some weird stuff when I try to do catalog that prevents me from messing with any of the files. No, that doesn't work. weird. So the text file, okay, so when you do exec, exec on a text file, it acts as though whatever's in that text file is being typed in. So whatever that file has in it, it just tried to, do a bunch of commands and pressed enter a whole bunch. All right, so whatever these are, they're not meant to be human readable. What was that called? Desk.0. See, if I had the internet when I was a kid, I would have been able to do all kinds of crazy stuff I wasn't supposed to. What are some other disks that had text files on them? I think BloodQuest? Yeah, Answers. No, it's just doing a bunch of syntax errors. Not direct command. Weird. I don't know. It must be protected somehow. I don't know how. I must be trying to use disks with different versions of DOS or something. So yeah, all of the documentation on FireOrgan are in binary format. Assembly language in a lower level. What's lower than assembly? Binary? Let's see. Does Defender have any text files on it? I don't think so. I think it's just the basic program. Yeah, this must be like ProDOS or something. I'm just trying to figure out if it's possible to read a text file like that. I don't know what not direct command means. It's so weird. So instead of having a hello program for Jeopardy, it just executes that text file. Oh, maybe by not direct command it means it has to be in a program. Like maybe I can write a little basic program to No, that's part of the basic program. Wait, what's this program actually doing besides printing text to the screen? H tab and V tab, that just means, you know, move the cursor that many spaces. Yeah, there's no hello program, which is weird. All right, let's try loading up Adventure to Atlantis again. Which I'm going to have to start with the master disk. All right. Try. Out of data error. What? Okay, so it's not recognizing open as a command. I wish there was an easy way to tell what version of DOS a disk is running, because you have DOS 3.3 and ProDOS, and I know it's not ProDOS because it has like an extra splash screen on it, but I think there might be some older versions of DOS that some of these disks might run. Yeah, I didn't think that would work. Out of data. Yeah, I don't know what I need to do to actually read that. Okay, here we go. Read clues 00. No? Nope. Oh, here we go. DOS error codes. What's error number 15? Oh, not direct command. Okay. Well, that makes sense. I don't know why sometimes it tells me the error, sometimes it just gives me the error code. Executes a text file as if every line was typed. It's not recognizing that. Well, write should totally be a command in DOS 3.x. Reserves buffers for disk input output. Maybe this master disk is just not formatted correctly. Let's see. So I can do this version of Defender. Nope, wrong one. I guess either one would have worked. Yeah, it's not recognizing that as a valid command. Yeah, file not found. That's what I thought. See, it says it recognizes it as a command. It's not giving me a syntax error. But I don't know why it wouldn't be working in a basic program. I'm just wondering how you actually create a text file. I don't know what that's supposed to do. In this list of commands, it says traces DOS 3.3 commands. Reserves buffer for disk IO. See, if it was ProDOS, then there's a create command. Maybe I could create a text file that way. Sorry, I haven't taught this much in a while. My voice is starting to get a little wonky. Oh, hey, Gunstar Hero and Aseb, welcome. You need quotes with writes. Right, am I trying to load a disk? Yeah, I think I tried it with quotes. Yeah, it still doesn't want to. Sorry, I didn't have the chat up. I was looking at some commands. Yeah. Well, let's try something with ProDOS real quick. So my ultimate goal is to... So I have the game Adventure to Atlantis here. And it has a text file on the disk called clues. And my ultimate objective is to just read that file. But I would think if it had anything in it, then it would type it all out when I type exec clues. which I'm wondering what the if that does what I'm thinking it actually does in NIT. Doesn't that format the disk? Try something with ProDOS real quick. So with ProDOS, it works a little bit differently than DOS 3.3. So catalog gives you sort of the full list here, and cat gives you like a truncated list. So, okay, I have a text file called play.intro, practice.txt. Was called play intro. So I can use Control S to stop it, and it looks like I can use Control C to break out of it. Yeah, that doesn't. Nah, I appreciate the help, Gunstar Hero. Let's see. So in ProDOS, I can create. So I have a file called. I should have a file called blah now. Yeah, and it's a directory. So I guess in ProDOS, you can actually have a directory structure. I don't know how to display current directory or changes current directory with prefix. Oh, look at that. Almost like MS-DOS. Okay, so yeah, I can list the basic program based off of Unix cell. Huh. Now that's something I know absolutely nothing about. So ProDOS still does not want to accept open as a command. Under exec, it says executes a text file as if every line was typed. So that leads me to believe that it is typing what's in that text file, but it is not like maybe it's a bunch of like control commands or something. I'm not sure. Text editing your okay, so this is just an editor. Oh, wait. Save the file to a disk as an ASCII or text file. Be sure it's a ProDOS formatted disk. Okay, but how do I save it as a text file? So this is like an excerpt from a magazine, I think, where it suggests when you're typing in basic programs from a magazine, it recommends saving it as a text file and then having it typed in with the exec command. But it doesn't say how to actually save something as a text file. Maybe. No. It probably has something to do with poke and peek. That stuff always baffled me. Yeah, this is getting into like memory management, which is outside of the scope of what I understand. Oh, wait. Here's something. Okay. No, it doesn't want to accept write. So here it says, when you do exec, it executes the basic and DOS commands found in a text file. Okay, so it's probably just a program, but saved as a text file. Maybe there's an Apple program that'll just handle it for me. Let's see here. Here's like a teletext thing. Let's see if this helps. Oh, sorry, Gunstar Hero. I'll try that in a second. Oh, program too large, huh? Well, I'm using this as an enhanced Apple IIe in the emulator, so I don't know what else I can do here. How do I get my mouse cursor back? I don't know what the hell this thing is. Oh wait, that was a different disc, right? Transferring program to tt.basic. I don't know how I'm supposed to run this program. I don't have any like additional RAM options in the emulator. Yeah, the only other thing I have that would be, or that's coming up when I search for text, is Text Adventures. Alright, well, this is clearly something I'm not going to figure out, but I'll keep looking into it and see if I can crack into that clues file, because I'm really curious what's in there. But thank you, Gunstar Hero, and Aseb, for hanging out and watching. I'm sorry I was a little preoccupied, but I really appreciate you coming by. You know, before you two arrived, I played a bunch of games and I was messing around with some programs. So watch the YouTube archive if you're interested in that. Played a bunch of Adventure to Atlantis, and I was very confused. Not as confused as I was trying to use these commands, but, oh, well, my connection just died, so they can't hear me anyway. Oh well, thanks everyone for watching, and I will see you soon. I still have plenty of Apple II junk that I wanna take a look at, so I will do that before you know it. Bye, everyone.